Good morning, everybody, and especially good morning, Dr. Wooten. I want to remind everyone, Bob is a little impatient today. He kept texting me, it's 8 o'clock, it's 8 o'clock. We have a PhD with us today, folks. We have Dr. Marty Wooten. And I believe that etiquette requires students to wait at least 30 minutes if you're in a class with the doctor. Isn't that correct, Dr. Wooten?
Oh, at my level, 2 minutes.
Well, then they're all gone. So good to see you, Marty.
It's good to be here. I can't see you guys because somehow we messed up with the PowerPoint.
We can all see you. And
I'm just going to go through my PowerPoint stuff and talk about it. I'm hoping people are interested in it.
Let me say the Lord's Prayer and then just. Yeah. You take off, our Father who is in heaven, how great is your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Please give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Please deliver us from evil. Please watch over our children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, hello, Steve, and whoever is watching.
We got Sherry and Bob already, and others will trickle in here, and they'll make comments. But Bob wanted you to know that Bob says good morning.
Well, good morning, Bob.
So,
but I just want to say a couple of things. Maybe get
please go ahead
more people on. You know that little song that you do with the eavesdropping introduction.
Yeah.
One of those birds sounds like it's dead. It's dying. Have you heard that?
Those are red-winged blackbirds. They sound perfectly healthy to me. That's what a red-winged blackbird sounds like.
One of them right in the middle sounds like he's screeching.
Marty Wooten joined.
Oh, I don't know. I think it's your connection. It dropped for a second. Okay. Dropped right back. It's good. But forget about the dead blackbirds. Tell us what you want to tell us. Go ahead.
Well, I got some things I want to deal with first. I'm okay. Having problems because I was always taught eavesdropping was wrong.
Well, I wouldn't say that what we're doing isn't wrong. This could be all wrong. Oh man, please don't do
Marty
this.
Wooten joined.
If I eavesdrop,
I don't know what's for some reason you're dropping off today. Is there anything different with your connection there in Louisiana?
You know, I don't know.
Well, we'll just keep going because you keep popping back. That's all that matters to me.
Okay.
But, everything about eavesdropping could be wrong. I who knows?
Well, I grew up, you know, I was always eavesdropping on my sisters when they had slumber parties and all that kind of stuff. And on my brother when he had his friends over. And I always got in trouble for it. So I just, when I saw eavesdropping, I went, hey.
I think everybody who eavesdrops on us is going to get in trouble. I believe that.
Okay. And also, after I got off last time, or before I got on, we actually got going, you said that after my first time on the thing here, the live stream, you got the approval from 4 people. And I got home and I was saying, who are these 4 people?
I think I said 2. I think it was 2 people. I don't remember 4 people that liked you.
Well, that's what bothered me. I said, is there a Sanhedrin out there or something that has to approve what I do before I get the thumbs up?
I don't remember saying, if your memory is better than mine, there's a whole council here. There's a council and you have to make like a year's worth of appearances before you are qualified to apply for the council. And then there's a huge vetting process. And when the vetting process is over, you pay your fee and you get to be on my approval board.
Hmm.
That's how I pay my mortgage.
And you call it the Sanhedrin, do you?
No, you called it that. No, yeah, I
think that's what it is.
I call it minions.
Oh, and I bet you have women on the Sanhedrin, don't you?
Wow. You know, the truth of the matter, if I had one, I would. But the truth is, I have no minions these days, so it doesn't exist. But that's how I would do it. I would cut the year down to something monetary. You know, just pay me money and you do what you want. I'm all about the money.
Yeah, that's kind of what I figured. I knew I was getting into something.
So I've heard.
I'm not sure about this club anymore. I was kind of excited about it.
Don't ever. You remember Groucho? He was right. You don't ever want to be in a club that would have you as a member.
Well, I guess we better get on with.
I will tell you. Well, before you go, I'll just say you are in a group with many people who love you very much, and the ones who don't love you very much already like you and are coming and getting to know you. So you're amongst friends. Those that agree with you and those that disagree with you, you're amongst friends.
Well, those that disagree with me, I don't consider my friends. I don't know where you picked that up.
Well, I need to get a little light here that flashes every time you're joking. people need to get to know you. But
yeah, I guess I better.
This is an astute crowd. They can get irony and sarcasm and all of those things. You're a teddy bear. People don't know that. But go ahead. Come on. What in the world did you come here for today?
I thought you and I were just talking. I didn't know what to do.
I like that. I appreciate that.
No, that's, I don't talk.
That's what I like to do. But I do know you had some thoughts on your mind, and you're a well prepared person. So which road are you going to do? I
was going to, if we could have worked it out, get the PowerPoint on where everybody can see it, but somehow on my end.
James Lloyd can figure out how to do PowerPoint, but he's got two screens. You've only got one, so that might be part of the problem.
Well, I'm not.
Let's not worry about that. We came to hear you, so it doesn't matter. We can see you. We can hear you. Talk to us.
Oh, you can see me. Oh, I'm sorry how I look, but I can't help that.
You look wonderful.
What I want to talk about, I guess the title of this PowerPoint presentation, and I did it for the church here, but then I've gone back and redone it and edited and all of that. But I'm calling the overall concept overcoming intellectual confusion. Because I just found in my ministry and just my own conversations with people and relatives through the years that there is a lot of confusion out there intellectually. Like I said last time, it's not so much an issue of us being in the battle for against, intense persecution or suffering or capital punishment for what we believe, but it's really an intellectual battle that we face. And a lot of Satan is very crafty. He throws a lot of different things our way that really leave Christians, many Christians that I've experienced or had time with, leave them confused. They believe they want to do the right thing. They know they need to do the right thing, but they're in an environment where they're being really tested intellectually. Can they really defend the faith, in those areas where people are asking questions? And that's confusing, and it's sometimes humiliating. I remember feeling when my older sister was married, she had a very intellectual husband, and he'd ask me these questions, and I couldn't answer them, and I felt humiliated. I guess I was just being prideful, but, I've he always asked me about the problem of evil and God of the Old Testament and this, that, and the other. And it just, when I left, I just felt confused. And I think that's where Satan really is going to go after us, in our doubts, to make us doubt in believing in the way, the truth, and the life in a very relativistic society and academic environment. Everything's relative, everything's subjective now. Existentialism is just run rampant. And I wanted to give a little bit of a background to what I'm saying from a biblical perspective, because over in Matthew 4, you have Jesus and the temptation that he was facing when he went into the desert. And it says in verse 2, after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones become bread." And then down verse 5 and 6, he says the same thing. But the temptation is to, you know, throw himself down. But he throws that, "If you are the Son of God."
Mm-hmm.
And that is Satan's main weapon, is for us to doubt in what we see, doubt in what we ought to believe, to doubt it. It's ridiculous. We're too narrow-minded. And here Satan knew who Jesus was. Jesus knew who he was. But what was Satan going after? So going after that doubt. I mean, that word "if" is huge here. If? Are you kidding me? If? You know, he's looking for doubt, or Jesus say, "Yeah, man, I don't know anymore. Let me see if I still have the power here." And he turns, you know, he's trying to get him to turn the stones to bread out of his insecurity, out of his doubt. Not so much out that he was demonstrating his power, but he would be demonstrating his power to himself. Why would he need to do that if he was secure in who he was? And I think that's that. The more I think about it, the more I see the danger of Satan's craftiness intellectually. I mean, he knows how to jam us up and to confuse us. There's so many things out there that our kids are facing today, just outlandish type of things in our school systems that are going on, you know. And it just leaves Christians oftentimes just in a confused state, a tornado, a tsunami of information and questions and things that can raise doubts. So anyway, I think I made enough point on that. But the challenging questions that come up, and you might have some of these questions yourself, but one is, can we objectively know there is a God? Can we say as Christians, "Yes, I know there is a God"? You know, these questions that people ask us sometimes, and we have to know that we can objectively know that, and I'm going to be showing that, but that's a question that might come into our own mind. Can I really say I know for sure, absolutely, there's a God? And if you answer that, then the next question is, well, where did he come from? The Mormon Church teaches that behind God the Father, there's another God the Father, and another Father, and another Father, and another Father. It's an infinite regress, which in reality, from a reality perspective, an empirical perspective, that's impossibility. Just have infinite regress in a cause and effect system. It has to stop somewhere for there to be actual physical empirical existence. And so I can remember when I first heard that, I went, "Whoa, wow, you know, there's a lot of theories and teachings out there about God. And I was studying philosophy at the time, and I was a Christian and studying Christian theology and philosophy. And it was just like, you know, so much reading material. And I went to school of theology to get some answers. And I found myself after a couple of years having more and more questions that were just coming up in my mind. I was going, what the heck have I gotten myself into? But what I was learning the tools of the trade. I was learning how to think. I was learning how to be logical. I was learning how to be critical. Dr. Carol Osborne taught me a lot about critical thinking as far as historical background. And Dr. Warren taught me a lot about just reasoning and the logical process and what a real contradiction is and what it's not, and really helped me in that perspective. But anyway, my mind was just, you know, spinning around and trying to get a handle on where can I really land? Because I don't know if you ever heard of this theologian, Soren Kierkegaard. And he believed in this leap of faith. He said, there's so much information kind of coming at us, and we have to go with the truth of our own lives and our own consciences and what's right and wrong for us. And you just eventually have to just make a leap of faith, he called it. You just have to jump. And hopefully you land where you want to land. Or you might land in Buddhism. You might land in a lot of different things. But you just leap out of faith. Well, that's not real faith. I don't mind leaping, but I want to have a knowledge base that I know is objectively true before I leap. I want to know that I'm leaping into something that's real and not just part of my imagination or part of how I was raised. And I can remember, what was it, last time you said we were talking about faith. And you jump out of an airplane with faith, but you don't know. You don't really know. But see, that gets back to, but what do you know? You're not just jumping out of there without any knowledge. You're jumping out of there because you know that the probability is that you're going to land safely, or you wouldn't jump.
There's a confidence, and I like listening to you. I have a hunch that you take a step further towards what we can absolutely know that I'm willing to do right now, but I want to more than just hear you out. I'm looking for a morsel from you that will help my faith. When the thing that doesn't trouble me, the thing that logic was an invention of the Greeks, right? I mean, the Greeks were the first ones in history, as far as we know, that came along. If I got that right, I mean, before logic, it was, if I bump my head into a table, the table God hates me. You know, it was, wow. And then someone said, well, whoa, wait a second. Maybe that doesn't make any sense. And with logic, and it's part of the birth of critical thinking, I guess you could say. But to me, the fact that logic is something that faith predates logic. There were faithful, we have to presume, because of our faith in the scriptures, that before anyone ever figured out logic, there was faith. And the way I read Hebrews, that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I don't read that. Look, you've got this evidence, so you're an idiot not to have faith. I read that I have faith even though the evidence isn't seen, even though it's a substance of something I'm hoping for. I'm more in Kierkegaard's camp, to be honest, and have been most of my life, because ultimately The only thing I know about absolutes is the more we believe in absolutes, the more likely we are to be absolutely wrong about something. I was so absolutely sure of so many things when I was younger. I mean, weren't you? That now I look at and I think, well, that wasn't good thinking, or that was, I mean, my heart was in the right place, but my head wasn't. So, but I'm here in this conversation, besides the fact that I just love talking with you. I'm thinking, if I shut up, and if we listen to you, even if it's hard to agree at first, I think you might offer a way to think through this that isn't as murky. Because I'm your target. Forget about anyone else. Relativism causes I sleep fine at night, but I go to sleep and wake up thinking about how relative everything is. If I can't have an absolute take on a number of different subjects in my mind, then how am I, and who am I to judge somebody else by their position on things? So I think, and when I say I need you in my life, I think that at this age and this time, I think you can pull me a little. I don't feel like I have drifted away, but I feel like I'm in deep water. And maybe you're on a rock and can give me a hand. Does that make sense? The parachute thing to me is the best way I can sum it up. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows when they jump out of a plane if they're going to live or not. To me, it is one of the most unnecessary, unless you're in some sort of life and death situation. Mm-hmm. Jumping out of a plane with a parachute is one of the most unnecessary activities anyone needs to be involved in. It is a total step of faith. It's built on a lot of confidence and a lot of experience and a lot of knowledge and a lot of practice and a lot, but ultimately you do not know if it's going to open or not.
Oh, sure. You don't know that for sure. But what do you know?
A lot.
What you know is the probability. You know the probability is on your side. That so, most people that jump out of a plane.
So far. Yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh.
But you do not know, because it's a probability. You know the probability, so you know there's a probability that you will not make it safely. But the probability is on your side. You know that, or you wouldn't jump. If someone said, look, you can jump, but there is, you know, no chance you're going to do it safely. You're going to go, really? I ain't jumping then. Why? Because the probability is not in your favor. You know that the probability is not in your favor.
Let me interrupt you. I have to focus on, but every once in a while I see something out of the corner of my eye. David, I'm saying David says, Steve, with all you've read and seen and been through, are you saying that now you are struggling with your faith in God? No, I'm saying the opposite of that. I'm saying all I have is faith in God. It's faith, but faith, while it can be fed by knowledge and fueled by knowledge, faith and knowledge are two different things.
Okay. I still affirm the position that faith is knowledge of the unseen.
I'm listening.
You don't have to know everything about the unseen. And we're going to get down to the point where you're going to see most of what we need to have a relationship to God has to come through revelation. But because God is a God of love, mm-hmm. He has to communicate. Mm-hmm. If he doesn't communicate, he's not a God of love, because that's essential to any kind of relationship. Mm-hmm. So he has to communicate to us.
Well, let me add another element.
We have to be able to know that what we're getting from the metaphysical realm is really from the Creator.
And listen, and you know, you're again. Let me use the analogy. You're a 344 Magnum talking to a 22 caliber brain, or maybe a BB brain here. I'm not, and that's not me putting myself down. I'm just saying there may be a limitation in the way I think, but maybe I'm a pretty good lab rat for you to work on. The thing is, belief belief and knowledge aren't the same thing. We know that. And belief, and we can take belief and you can have a belief and think you know and be completely wrong. But I think believing in God is a really important step towards faith. I believe. Belief and faith we know are different. At least saving faith isn't just believing. It's believing and following, or believing and obeying. It's believing and trusting. That's the difference in the devil believes and trembles, you know. So I think it's important to believe in God. I do believe in God. I think it's important to have faith in God. I've got a lot of knowledge. I've seen a lot. I've read a lot. I've got I got more knowledge than I know what to do with. It's almost useless in this contraption I've got for a brain. But it still is different from I am very, very subject to, I think you summed it up to relativism. Right now in this existence, I know that's the table. That's logic 101, right? And when we're talking, you know, how can we know that we exist and take that to a plane where we know that God exists? Now, I can shift just a little bit and say, because of my strong faith, I operate and live. I mean, I talk to God. I hear and see God in different ways. I believe in God. But for me to tell someone who hasn't got that faith that they are absolutely wrong, that I know for a fact there is a God, let me prove it to you. Teach me how to do that, because I've lost the way to do that. I can teach people why I think they ought to believe in God. I can teach people why I think it's better to believe in God. I can teach people what is wonderful about God. And I can teach people that, yeah, God's a God of love and he's communicated with us. But to say as you can, and I know that there's bluster to you, and I've grown to, because I love you, there's a lot of bluster.
What? You said what now?
I know there is some bluster to you. I know when you say I can mop the floor with any atheist, I know there's some bluster there, because I know in your heart you love. That to some people that can come. That's to me. And I don't even want to get to a point, and you never would. To me, it's not about mopping the floor with anyone except my brain. Is what can I do?
Did I say mopping the floor?
I think so. But that's let's not get sidetracked. Your character to me is one that is, for me, it's charming. For me, it's you. There's
blustery.
You are a verbal brawler, and that's if I was a kid.
Brawler,
you'd be my favorite teacher. You would be the class we'd all want in if I was a kid. There's some other kids that would cower away. I shouldn't have said cower. There's other kids that would say, but for me, but no, let's stay on. Let me try to stay on the point.
No, you have you have painted me in a very negative way, and I have a right to respond.
Go ahead, please. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to, but go ahead.
What do you mean by blustery? that sounds, you know, I was raised in England, and they taught, oh, look at that blustery bloke. You know, that sounds like an English word, blustery. I mean, from England. Mm-hmm. I was from England, but you know what I'm saying? I've never had anyone refer to me as blustery.
Before you tear me apart, let me tell you one of the things that I think we need in this group, and why I'm so glad that you'll be here, is there we live in a world with much more uncertainty, And it really is a time that even I am an advocate of. One of the scariest things to me is a person that is absolutely sure they're absolutely correct about absolutely everything. There's a book that I need to get around to reading. I think it's called The Myth of Certainty. And we live in a time where people are, you know, well, you can't be certain. I think we can be certain about some things. When it comes to faith, I think there's a certain amount of certainty we can have about it. And I think you've got the tools and the brain and the heart to help us to know how having faith is something that we can have. We can stand on a rock. I think a lot of people these days, not just in this group, I think a lot of folks that have come through our fellowship and who no longer want to be in that kind of fellowship, I think one of the things that's off-putting is if they feel like someone is so certain that they won't, that they can't listen or they can't hear the objections or the questions. So I think you're a person that can hear it and can respond. I think maybe I should say sometimes you're blustery. You're not always. You let your curtain down, and I think I've seen the puppy dog in you a lot, and that's why someone that could tear my head off easily, I'm not scared of you, Marty, because I know you, and you're a good man. So anyway, I don't know if that all makes sense, but there's we need strong faith. It's absolutism that we fear.
Well, yeah, I don't know where to start now.
Well, keep going. I like where you were going. No, I like where you were going. It was fine. You asked me a question about the parachute, and here.
Let me just say what I'm trying to do.
Please.
I'm trying to hit at the foundation of the Christian faith. I'm not here to talk about ministry methodology or disputable matters. I mean, if you want to talk about a disputable matter, then we can talk about it. If it's two sides of something, they both seem reasonable, then you have disputable matters, and I tip my hat to you and go on my way. And that's not what I'm all about. I'm certainly not about bullying. I grew up being bullied. I learned how to fight because I was so bullied. High school was a very terrible time for me. And I don't like a bully. Mm-hmm. I don't like a spiritual bully. And I have fought spiritual bullies and taking licks and all of that. That's a whole nother thing. I am not for that in any way. I want people to be able to think through why they believe. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have a reason that you believe, Steve. I mean, it's not just, well, I'm just happy to be raised the way I'm raised, and therefore, I guess I'll just go down this road. No, you look out into the creation, and what do you see? You see the footprint of God. That's evidence. Mm-hmm. The complexity of the universe is absolute empirical evidence. Where do you get that kind of complexity? Look at our own bodies. You know, just look at the environment. And you mentioned that the Greeks invented logic. No, logic wasn't invented. It was discovered. Basically, Aristotle sat down and figured out how do we think. So logic was in process way before the Greeks, because God made us logical. He made us to think. He gave us a brain that's more powerful than computers. And he gave us a great sense, a great common sense. We can evaluate what is true and we can evaluate what is false very, very quickly in our minds. When we see a contradiction, I was thinking about this last night, about how quickly the brain processes information and locates a contradiction. Like, let's say I'm going to the grocery store and I want to surprise Kathy. So I sneak in there and I see her. I go, oh no, there she is. So I know that I saw my wife in the grocery store. No question about it. Empirical evidence. I get home and she comes in and she says, and I say, hey, I have a bottle of champagne and some roses. And I go, hey, how you doing? I love you so much. And yeah, I saw you at the store and I snuck out so you wouldn't see me. And she says, I wasn't at the store. Yes, you were, honey, you're at the store. I saw you at the store. Wasn't anybody else? Same clothes? Saw the car in the parking lot? You were at the store. No, I wasn't at the store. Now, what is your brain doing? It's not going, well, you know, everything's relative. Maybe she really, you know, in her mind, she wasn't at the store, so maybe she really wasn't at the store. That's not how God made our minds. As soon as she says she wasn't at the store, I'm thinking she's lying. She's contradicting herself. Because I saw her. That's just common sense. You go to the store and you give a person $20 for a $5 whatever you're buying. You give him $20 for a $5 item. He gives you $3 back. What does your mind automatically do? Whoa, wait a minute, buddy. You didn't have to sit there and process that and go, let me see. He counted that, from his perspective, he's right. From my perspective, I'm right. I can't really judge him for being wrong. That's not how your brain thinks. You're going, dude, you give me that money or we're going to have a problem. You know, that's my blustery side at the grocery store. I can be very blustery. You're supposed to laugh, Steve, or say something. Are you still there?
I'm still here.
I guess
I haven't heard you be blustery yet today. So.
Oh, good. Well, I don't want to be. I'm really working on that because I have to admit, my son. I don't want to share this to confirm your negative opinion about me. But my son has challenged me about coming across a little strong.
Well, there you go. There's
my wife has challenged me that because my hearing's going, I'm raising my voice and I'm shouting all the time. My daughter said about a month ago that, Dad, why are you shouting at me? I didn't think I was shouting.
Mm-hmm.
And so obviously you've hit a nerve and I don't appreciate you digging around in my life if I'm going to come on this thing here. I'm trying to help. I don't want to be all criticized. But anyway, what were we talking about?
Well, you were talking about you saw Kathy in the grocery store and she lied to you. You know, the birth of truth, whatever truth, of course, truth is truth. I read someone really smart. I wish I had retention. I talked about it last year sometime even. Truth was really important for the survival of our species. Learning truth and trust. I mean, if you and I are going out hunting a woolly mammoth and I can't trust you, you say, yeah, I got your back. Yeah, you run it, you know, you get it to chase you and I'll push this boulder down in its way, you know, and okay, and it's chasing me and no boulder comes down because you ran away, you know. Well, you're not trustworthy. So at our next tribal meeting, we're probably going to kill you. You know, we'll just, you know, and so trust became a very important part. Truth became, and so when you go in and see Kathy and she lies to you, if we take that back a few thousand years, that would probably sever the relationship right there. You know, that would be all it would take because we can't live like this. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, this grocery store we're in, we've never been in it before. There's been people before us and people before that, but we can imagine a time that no one has ever done this before. We can amalgamate, if that's the right word. We can put every human that's ever existed. We can be proto-Adam here. And we are thrust into a grocery store that we've never been in. And we've got this process of learning, what can I trust? What can I believe? What is true? What isn't true? And to me, the good Christian and the good agnostic are two sides of the same coin. It's someone saying, I can't prove that there isn't a God anywhere in the universe, but I choose to believe in God because this all, you know, where there's a creation, there must be a creator. Where there is art, there must be a painter. And the other person says, I can't prove there isn't a God, so I'm not going to tell you you're wrong, but I also can't prove that there is a God because he's never spoke to me through a burning bush. He's never shown me the nail prints in his hands. See, my faith, I think, is directly linked to the Jesus Thomas episode where Jesus said, blessed will be those that don't get to touch the holes, that don't get to see what they're, you know, blessed are those that believe. And I'm one of the ones, I believe based on their testimony. That's testimony that would hold up in court. That's evidentiary. But it's still faith. It's not the same. And I'm not saying it isn't built on some knowledge or a lot of knowledge. Quantify the knowledge however you want. Faith is a Kierkegaard leap at some point. At some point, everybody does have to step out of the plane. One person, we're in the plane. You've never jumped out before and it's going down. They happen to have two parachutes. I've jumped out before. I say, Marty, put it on. It's going to be okay. You're going to have, a normal person would have a lot of fear. How can I believe it? How can I trust it? They don't have the same experience. They don't know who packed the chute. They don't know the process that goes into packing a chute and what the safety backups are and what the regulations are. But I do. I've happened to do it before and so done it before. And so I say, put this on. Trust it. I'm jumping out with more faith, with more knowledge. You're jumping out with nothing but faith. Nothing but faith and your trust in Steve and I'd rather do this than go down with the plane. That's where most people who walk into our churches are. I'd rather believe this than go to hell. Hell sounds awful. And I've done all these things that mean I deserve to go to hell. Hell's really, I don't. And a lot of people are grabbing a chute that we hand them. And they're jumping out based on all of this knowledge and experience and teaching and stuff. But to me, it's difficult to where you come in right now for me, and I won't speak for anyone else, is I need another shot that takes my faith higher and stronger. I don't think a shot exists until judgment. I don't think until, as Paul said, that now we look through a glass darkly, but then we'll see face to face. I don't think that I'm going to have the kind of knowledge it seems you talk about until I see face to face. That's why the other thing Paul said, the faith, love, and hope. That's what we've gotten. The greatest of these is love. To me, that's what is so beautiful about faith is that I think Kierkegaard was right. you go down this path long enough, no matter how smart, no matter how much proof, no matter how much evidence, you have to jump out the plane. And I know you're still here because I can see you.
Are you done? I didn't know if you were done. I didn't.
Yes, it's hard. It's hard sometimes. I know.
What?
To know if I'm done.
Oh, okay. I thought you'd just taken a pause.
No, I forgot to get my glass of water. I could have taken a drink. Then you wouldn't have known. No, please. That was my little. That was me being. Was I blustery?
No, not blustery. I don't know what to say because I don't want to. I feel like now I'm kind of in a political situation because I don't want to say anything that is going to put salt in the wounds of anybody who's listening. I feel like I've got to be careful about what I say because I don't want people to feel like they have no faith or anything like that. So I'm kind of
no.
If I can just talk to you and I guess just hand it over to the Lord that I'm not hurting anybody's faith.
Absolutely. People are eavesdropping on your and my conversation. And maybe I'm not being clear. I think you have something we all need. And what I'm doing is conversing. I'm not speaking for anyone else. This is me wanting you to argue with me, to help me, to poke it. This is me wanting you to poke at me. And because I think you have something that will only help faith. I don't think it will hurt faith. And but sometimes you pause and you'll ask a question. And so this is where you've led me. This is where you've led me so far. This is what you've led me to. This is bubbling over inside of me. And I didn't know it a month ago. But I have just been looking for someone like you to talk to me because I talk to so many different people that have so many different opinions about so many different things. And we never always agree on everything. I don't have many friends who talk like you anymore.
Blustery.
No, brother Marty. No,
I'm just rubbing it in, brother. Relax.
I've had enough professors and people here are astute enough to know in the battle of minds, there have been periods, eras where Christians were looked at as idiots, right?
Oh, yeah.
And there is a tendency for people who know as much as you to show it's not stupid to be a Christian. And I think that's one of the reasons why I think we need people like you. I think to say, hey, look, my argument is as strong or even stronger than the other side. I think that's good. But just talk to me because folks, I don't know who's gun shy. I don't know if I should even use that, but people like listening to you. And so help me believe more. I believe. Help my unbelief.
Well, I think it goes back to what I'm hearing you say is, and I think you and I are not, I don't think, on a completely different plane. I just think, and I don't want to say it's completely a matter of semantics, but your concept of faith, I think, is or your definition of faith, your use of the word faith kind of throws me, because it's not what I perceive from the scriptures or just normal life to be accurate. It even though you jump out of a plane, you're jumping out of the plane with some knowledge. God made us rational. That's why we can discuss. That's why we argue. One person puts forth their position, the other one puts forth their position, and then hopefully they have the humility to really want to seek the truth, which normally doesn't happen when they're two contradictory sides. But God made us to be rational and logical and to know things. If I'm walking on a beach and I see footprints, I know somebody was walking. And those are footprints. Or somebody came by with a stick with a boot on it and they went and stomped along the way to fool everybody. But something happened. I know that. Why? Because it's evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk about, you haven't had a burning bush experience. Well, what do you think is up in the sky called the sun? It's not burning up. I mean, it's not burning up very fast. But, there's miracles all around us.
Mm-hmm.
Why is the sun in such perfect distance from the earth so that we're not completely burnt up?
And can I interrupt you just to say,
sure.
go on, but logically, there is a difference in me looking at these beautiful things that do bolster my faith. They do make me remember I am the one that falls on the side of, I can't prove it, but I believe it with all of my heart. There is a difference logically in God speaking audibly to someone and God and Jesus raising a dead body in front of you.
Then why isn't God?
There is a logical difference, isn't there, in Thomas putting his hands in the holes on Jesus' hands.
Yeah.
And okay. me not being there, but I tell people every week, I say, you can believe it because even today, if someone is an eyewitness, their testimony has got to be allowed in court, even if they have to write it, even if they can't show up, even if they're in the hospital, they can write it and it's legal testimony. So I believe it, but logically, there is a difference, isn't there, in the kind of experiences we read about in the Bible and the kind of experiences I'm supposed to manifest to have faith. Tell me why. I'm listening. Why not?
What Thomas was wanting was empirical knowledge. Because why? He lacked the faith to make the jump from what he saw Jesus raised from the dead to not having to see Jesus, just affirming his lordship. Mm-hmm. He wasn't able to make the leap. But there's two levels of existence. It's the physical world and the metaphysical world. We have access to information about the metaphysical world that is objective. You cannot get the kind of complexity that we see in the universe from dead rocks and dirt. Dead rocks and dirt do not produce intelligence. We know that. Therefore, what does produce intelligence? A higher intelligence. Therefore, I know there is a higher intelligence in the metaphysical realm that is much higher than me, in which I am obviously dependent because he created the complexity. I mean, the scientists are still trying to figure out what the human body is all about. Mm-hmm. Where does that come from? Dead dirt and rocks? And if the Big Bang is true, which I kind of lean that direction, you have a chaotic explosion. Mm-hmm. And you have all this complexity coming out of an explosion. Does not come out of chaotic state.
Understand this.
Yeah.
I agree with everything you're saying. That's why we're brothers in Christ. I mean, to me, believing in a higher intelligence, that's what I do. But my problem is this.
Okay, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Do you know that there is a God in the metaphysical realm? Are you saying there is not enough evidence? I'm getting my face real close here. I'm sorry.
I like that. No, do that again. That's good. I like that.
Can you say, do you know from your examination of the evidence, the complexity in the universe, the expanding universe, the complexity of the body and everything, looking at all that, saying you cannot know for sure that there is a power in the metaphysical.
I'm going to answer your question, and let me tell you the problem with my answer for me. Paul says, I know whom I believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep what I've committed. Paul says, I know. So I know, I think I know that I'm supposed to say, I know. But I'm still stuck with saying, I believe. But to say, I know.
Yeah, faith.
Do we live in an infinite, right now, as far as we know, do we live in an infinite universe? Do we know that?
Well, we know the ends of our universe, which is supposed to be 4 billion light years across, something like that. But who knows what's beyond that?
Well, they say multiverses now. I mean, it seems as if we're dropped into a finite existence in the midst of infinity, is what it seems to me. Ask me if I know, if I know, remember, one of my problems is, remember when we were young and at conferences, there would always be at least one speaker talking about evidences, and they would use the illustration of if I take this watch apart and throw it in the air, how many times would I have to throw it for it to come down back as a watch? Remember that illustration?
Yeah.
The problem is...
exactly that one, but yeah.
Well, the problem is, in an infinite universe, that might happen an unlimited amount of times. Our concept of infinity and numbers and all this... So when you say, do I know? The way this brain functions, I think... I act as if I know there's a God. I act that way. I believe that way. But when you're talking about we know, absolutely, I'm still stuck at the same place. It is a step of faith. It's not knowing like I know, like you know Kathy's in the grocery store, or I know Lisa's asleep in there getting ready to take up. She's been up all night taking pills, and she'll wake up for the next little nap, she'll wake up and she'll take some more pill. I mean, I there's certain things I know, but this is the mystery. This is the question of the ages. And you're right. I believe that we have treasure. I think it is treasure in a field. We have found the answer. This is the answer to the metaphysical world has been dropped in our lap through Jesus Christ. But I can tell you this and I want to be open. I want my mind at this age to be able to change in any positive way that it can. I don't want to say you'll never change my mind. You're one of the things I dig about our friendship is I have a lot of hopes that you will change my mind on a number of things. But one thing I've just, it's been with me from the time I was a teenager to now. If not for Jesus, the best I could hope for would be agnostic. Jesus is the only reason I can believe absolutely I should have faith in a God that created everything. Because God, I can't, my mind just goes in a million different directions. But the Word becoming flesh, Jesus, Jesus holds my hand and gets me through it.
You just have, what I hear you, are we over the time?
We can stop live streaming and talk about more important things if you want.
Well, you can keep the live stream going. I don't care.
We'll call it here in a minute, but I want you to have the last word for the live stream, and then we'll fight privately amongst ourselves.
Maybe next time I could have a few more words that might help you. I think you're at the you're on a high dive looking down at the water and someone needs to push you over. Cause I think it has a lot to do with the verbiage. You're hung up on this word faith. I believe in faith. I believe in a leap of faith, but I don't believe in a leap of uneducated faith or a faith that doesn't have a foundation of knowledge.
Yeah.
It's like Peter walked on the water, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he was walking on the water. It was an empirical fact.
Yeah.
It was objective. He was walking on the water. But what happened? The knowledge, for some reason, it's kind of crazy. He's walking on the water, yet he starts doubting that he can walk on the water. And Jesus is saying, you know, kind of, you're walking on the water. Why are you doubting that you can walk on the water? Because he was losing that knowledge base. It didn't make sense in his environment that you would stand on water, especially with the waves and the storm coming. But that was the issue with him. He had let go of faith. In other words, he wasn't making the leap anymore.
And see, for me, I'm sorry, were you finished?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
For me, our entire Christian life, we're walking on water if we have faith. We err, we sin, we drop in, but to me, I've got walking on water faith. But it defies the knowledge I have about almost everything else. To me, that's what I'm saying is I don't think our faith, I don't want to do a double negative. Yes, our faith, I totally agree. Faith needs to be built on knowledge. Knowledge is add to your faith goodness and the goodness knowledge and the knowledge self-control, right? I mean, knowledge is right in there with the things that we're supposed to have as believers.
Well, it's the access to truth that we are provided.
Well, and our truth is Jesus, and our truth is in a Jesus that raised from the dead. And we quickly get into, as you say, the metaphysical. We get into a world that a lot of people just do not know or believe that we can know. I'm not saying we can't know anything. And remember, please, we'll talk about this privately, and we can talk about it publicly. My goal isn't to argue with you to win. My goal is to lose. I think you know something I don't know, or I can't quite get a grasp. But I think you're right about me being on the diving board. But if we use that analogy, sometimes I've jumped and sometimes I haven't. Sometimes I've sat up there and I've just looked at everybody around the pool. But to me, I've listened to as you have, you've written books and I've read books, Josh McDowell, and I have to say if I was a young agnostic today and had not had my church experience and I read Josh McDowell's books. And I was in the universities, which are based largely on an atheistic point of view, or at least at the very best, an agnostic point of view. Josh McDowell probably wouldn't be convincing to me, because I would be hearing so many smart people talking about how can you know? How can you know? To me, the reason why on a graph, on this extreme, you've got the atheist that says, I'm so smart, I'm so wise, I've looked behind every rock in the universe, there is no God. God's God. How do you know? God could be hiding behind some rock. On the other end, there is this person that says, I know for a fact there's a God, and you're an idiot if you don't believe. To me, those extreme points of view would make me pick up Josh McDowell's book and say, this is interesting, and maybe I would want to believe. And if I fall in love with Jesus, I'm going to get pushed off of that diving board pretty quickly. But so many things we call evidences, there are other explanations for them in a universe or in multiverses as huge as we live in. But let's call this one. I don't want to apologize, because I cannot pay attention to you and read hardly any of the comments, and people have been chatting up a storm. And I hope you got time to get on Facebook and look at these comments. Brother, you are much needed and appreciated. Hang on, let's talk a little bit more, but we're gonna call this one. And thanks for hanging in there with us. I have no idea, Lord willing, what we're gonna be doing next week, but Lord willing, you'll come back next Friday, right, Marty?
I can come back any yeah. Friday can work.
We'll figure out. Maybe we'll do this on, maybe if Tuesday's open, maybe we'll just continue this. But I love you very much. And hang on a second. Let's stop this. Everybody, have a great weekend, and please believe in God.